Lindsay here, the Frugal Crafter. Today I'm going to share a bunch of different ways you can use watercolor pigment powders to make some really cute backgrounds for your handmade cards. They're a lot of fun to make and it gets you using some supplies that you might have kind of neglected. This video is brought to you by topflightstamps.com. The stamps I'm using are from their shop. They find the coolest stamps all over the world and bring them back to us here in the United States. And they also sell a product called Infusions, which is a watercolor pigment powder. And there are many different brands of watercolor pigment powders you can use. The thing I really like about the Infusions is that there are like three different colors per jar, so when you sprinkle it out, you get this burst of a variety of colors, which is really kind of fun. It gives you a depth of color, and you don't need to have a lot of different bottles of them to get a really good look, and they're a little bit cheaper than some of the other brands, so check the link in the video description for that. So I'm just kind of flipping through some of the backgrounds I made to give you an idea of the different techniques I'm going to show you today, and I just want to warn you, you might want to put gloves on before you start because your hands are going to get real messy, as you will see in today's video. But it's a lot of fun. You can get so many backgrounds done at once, and it gets out those maybe neglected supplies if you've had these sitting around and you haven't really used them. Or if you've been curious about them, you'll know whether they're for you or not, hopefully by the end of the video. There's so many different things you can do with these products. It's nice to just kind of play with them. And I recommend that you do. If you get these pigment powders out, make a bunch of backgrounds all at once. So I'm prepping a little bit here for my Brusho background session or my watercolor pigment powder session. I'm stamping a giraffe and this Paris rooftop scene with archival black ink, and I'm just going to set it aside to dry. I know I'm going to want to do a painting technique with those in a little bit, so I like to get all of my stamp stuff prepped and done so I can put my stamping mat away and then do all my messy stuff. Now, these script stamps by Quetzalcraft I thought were really nice and bold and would work really well for doing either just a regular stamped sentiment or doing a resist, because we're working with a watercolor product and that is going to resist embossing powder. So I'm just using some clear embossing powder with some clear ink, going to heat set that, and it's going to just make it glossy and raised, and that way any of those pigment powders won't stick to the wording. So I just wanted to try and experiment between using a sentiment with a black ink and then also with a resist, just to see the different types of looks that I can get. Now keep in mind, when you're doing a bunch of backgrounds, some are going to come out fantastic, some are going to be a little meh, you know, just play, okay? Just give yourself that chance to play. So here what I'm doing is I'm just going to sprinkle some powders randomly on this panel that we just stamped and resisted. Now I do like to spray the panel a little bit first because it helps those pigment powders cling, and that way they don't just like travel everywhere. Now you might want to wear a mask when you're working with watercolor pigment powders. I didn't, but then I blew my nose a little while later and I had orange on my tissue, so I'm pretty sure that was watercolor pigment powder. So it might not be a bad idea, especially if you have asthma or any sort of issues like that. So after doing the resist and sprinkling the powder on and spraying it, you can see that kind of firework background that you get. Now I did use a brush to spread the paint around over the resist so I get a really good contrast, but the rest of it I just kind of left it as is, and you'll see that as a finished card a little later on. I like an effect like this because it's interesting, it's really cool looking, and it doesn't take much to make a really stunning card. So if you're trying to send a lot of happy mail to your friends and relatives this day and age, which is a nice thing to do, it's a great way to get a bunch of cards made. Now, I wasn't that thrilled with these techniques. I wanted to try embossing some paper and then trying the watercolor pigment powders on top, and it was all right. It was kind of cute. It was kind of pretty because it would like grab the powder where it was embossed more, because where you have those raised areas, the paper's kind of been stretched and damaged a little bit, so it wants to grab the pigment a little bit more. But this is where I realized something really important when you're using watercolor pigment powders. The paper really makes a big difference. I was using up a bunch of white cardstock scraps that I had, and the white cardstock does not work as well with the watercolor pigment powders as a watercolor paper does. So if you have watercolor paper that you don't mind using for card backgrounds, I would highly recommend that when you're using your watercolor pigment powders. You'll get a much nicer result and it won't leak through to the back so much. Not that that's a big deal because you're going to put it down on a card, but you know, just keep it in mind. I wanted to try a variety of different types of designs. I tried like kind of geometric ones and like this bubbly one, just to see the variety that I could get And again, these ones are just plain cardstock. When I did the resist and when I did my stamping, I did that on a hot press watercolor paper. And when you are using watercolor paper for stamping, you do want something smooth. And hot press means it's, the paper's been pressed under hot rollers, and that's why it's smooth. So I decided to, a brief aside there about watercolor paper. I decided that for this bubbly one, I would do some kind of undersea colors and get some different kind of bubbly looks. I thought it might be cute if you did a card with like a fish on it or something. And I wasn't terribly impressed. My ink was seeping through because it was just cardstock. But honestly, if you're not happy with your backgrounds, just keep adding. Just keep playing with it until either you've exhausted the paper and it's disintegrating in your hands, or you've discovered something that you do like. Now, something like this, I decided to put on some of the pigment powder and then spray it really close so I could get this dripping effect, and that I really liked. So if all you have is just plain white cardstock from the office supply store, try it. Okay, what's the worst that's gonna happen? Watercolor paper or Bristol, any is more robust and it will work better, but your regular cardstock will work too. Just try what you have. Now for this one, it was another embossed panel, and I thought it'd be pretty to have some kind of like sunset-y colors on there. So what I did was I kind of sprinkled the powder towards the top of the design, and now I'm spraying and letting it drip down. And what I was thinking here was kind of like old doors that kind of have a patina, and I was just trying to get that kind of texture because I thought the embossing folder kind of reminded me of like old doors. I really liked how that came out. And the thing you'll notice with cardstock versus watercolor paper is that when you put that powder down, it really clings into the fiber of the cardstock because there's no sizing to really, help it move on the surface. And it does give you a really cool effect. So you'll figure out the paper that you have and the cardstock that you have, you'll figure out what works best for what. Now, this is a technique I really love. I'm just putting a stencil down on my watercolor paper and spritzing it with water. Now, I'm just going to puff some of the watercolor pigment powders across the paper, and look, it's catching everywhere there's water. I'm using blues and browns and oranges just to get kind of like a rusty patina look, and I just think it's such a pretty effect. Now, you can use, like I mentioned, any brand of powder that you like. I do notice the Ken Oliver Color Burst will let you puff the paint out of the powder out a little bit more, so it does work really well for this technique, but any will work. And then when you're done, shake off the excess and then give it a spray. You'll see that there is some leftover watercolor pigment dust here and there, so you will get color where you didn't see any before you spritzed it, but I think that gives you part of that distressed look and really artsy look that gives the pigment powders their kind of their classic look. Kind of like, it's kind of like impossible to repeat that look any other way but with powders. Now, if you don't have powders, you can always use a powder dye. And what I've had the best luck with, if I'm using just a regular dye, is the kind that come for tie-dyeing t-shirt kits and not the Rit dye, because the Rit has like a heavy salt in it. It doesn't work that well for this technique. You want just the pigment and none of the salts. So for these backgrounds, this is such a fun technique, and it's a really great excuse to try texture paste if you've never used it before. So texture paste is basically like a spackle, and what you're going to do is you're going to scrape it with either an old gift card or credit card or a palette knife across a stencil, and you can use a metal stencil, a plastic stencil, it doesn't matter. And so you're just going to, like you're frosting a cake, you're going to scrape that texture paste over your stencil. Try not to move your stencil because you don't want to get that paste underneath it. And then you can scrape any excess back into the jar so there's no waste. And when you lift off your stencil, you're going to see this really pretty design. Now, you've got to make sure you let that completely dry before you do the next step, because otherwise you're going to wash away all that paste. If you don't have texture paste, you can use some white latex caulking from the hardware store or from the dollar store. That'll work just fine. So use whatever you have. Now, texture paste comes in all sorts of colors. The one I did there with like that rock design underneath, that is a black texture paste. These other ones I used was a matte white texture paste. They come in pearl finishes, they come in gold, silvers, all kinds of colors. And you can even take the, you know, cheap dollar store caulking and mix acrylic paint in it to make your own custom colors too. So it works pretty much exactly the same. So if you have the fancy art supply stuff, great. If you don't, there you go. Go to the Dollar Tree, go to the hardware store, get some caulking. So for this, I want to have a lot of contrast with those black lines. So I want a little light on my powder, and it gave me a really cool, almost like paving stone look. Oh, and I wanted to mention, with this technique, plain cardstock is totally fine. You're not going to be seeing enough of the background for it to matter if you use watercolor paper or not. So go ahead and use the cheap stuff on this. It's because that it's a texture paste that's almost going to resist the color or just not absorb it so much and give you that texture. It doesn't really matter what you're making the backgrounds on. Now, this is one of my favorites. This is a kind of a mosaic pattern. It's from Dreamweavers, which is a metal stencil company. And I just think this is so pretty. And I'm really spraying that so I can kind of rinse the color off of the top of the texture paste and let it seep into the cracks. And I think that would look so cool on like any sort of like vintage card or anything that's like Mediterranean. I just think it's such a fun look. Now, any of that leftover color, you can sop up, take a white piece of cardstock and sop up the extra and not let it go to waste. So just keep playing, keep using up that ink. You could dye tissue paper with it. You could do whatever you want. I decided I would throw some kosher salt in this just to give it some cool texture. So when you have a background like that, that you're just sopping up ink and you don't really have anything fancy happening on there, just throw on some salt. Any kind of salt is fine, and you'll get a really cool texture when it's dry. I think it's fun to use a texture paste on stencils you might have had for decades because it gives them a whole new lease on life. And when you can take a supply and mix it with a supply you haven't used before, it just gives you so much more versatility. And that's why I think when you add a new supply to your stash, whether it be a pigment powder or a texture paste or a stencil, you want to add those supplies that make all your other supplies more versatile. And the way to do that is to start mixing and matching them up and seeing what you get. I really like this this kind of scribbly stencil too. That one's from Top Flight Stamps. If it's in stock, I'll link to it. It's just such a fun one. I like to use all over designs aren't too specific, so that way they could be for anything. I really thought this one here with a little kind of, it almost looks like confetti to me. I thought that looks so fun for like birthday or New Year's Eve. It just looks celebratory to me, like somebody just thrown confetti. Now here I was trying to refill my spray bottle and I completely dropped water on my background, but that doesn't matter because I can just dump off the excess, sprinkle on some powder, and you know, get cracking on another background. The thing I found, I have a tendency to be real heavy-handed when I'm using these pigment powders. It does take a little to get used to because they're so strong and bright and vivid. So that's why I recommend doing a big batch of backgrounds at once, because it will take you a while to get your groove, to get used to them, and to figure out how much to use. Now you can actually stamp with these powders, and it's a kind of a fun effect. What I did was I just loaded up the stamps with clear ink, just your Versamark, your embossing ink, and then I just sprinkled on some of the powders, and now I'm giving them a spritz to activate them, and then I'm just going to stamp a background with it. Now you can't expect perfect results because you're not inking it up with a stamp pad. You're going to get drips, and you're going to get drabs, and you're going to get splashes. But that's part of the fun because you get some really cool effects. Now, something that I made a mistake here is that those colors are really bright and I was stamping over a sentiment. And really what I should have done was I should have had behind the sentiment be really soft and blurred so that you could read it. And this card didn't turn out because of that. I wasn't able to make the sentiment stand out enough. Once I stamped that on that paper, it was like stuck and I really couldn't make out the sentiment as much as I wanted to. I like my it's a personal thing, but I like my, if I got sentiments as a focal point on a card, I'd like them to really pop, and that one just didn't. But anyway, I like the technique, and so I decided to try it on a few other pieces of white cardstock and just make a few more backgrounds. Now you'll notice that when you spritz it with water after you've stamped, it's gonna release more pigment because you're gonna have some of those crystals that are just sitting there on the top of your paper that haven't really soaked in, and they're really kind of strong and concentrated, and that ink is going to just go wild when you spray it. So you get these really fun effects, and just think of all the stamps you have in your stash. You know, use some of this technique. You can get like an endless variety of different papers, and you can get endless varieties of colors as you stamp over and you experiment and play. Now here I kind of went a little crazy on the stamping, I mean on the spraying, and I had so much ink there that I thought I would try another technique with this. Now what I wish I had done was put another piece of paper down on that instead of the rag, instead of the paper towel, because I would have got another background if I put a piece of paper towel down there. I mean, if I put a piece of cardstock down there. This I wanted to see if I blotted it off, if I would get a cool impression, and it wasn't really as exciting as I'd hoped. So that was kind of a bummer, but I am going to show you a technique with that stencil that turned out really well in just a minute. So there's so many different things you can do with stencils. Totally look at what you have in a new light, because you're going to find that you get some really interesting backgrounds. Now this, I just took that dirty stencil and pressed it on a new piece of paper to see what would happen, and it gives you kind of a ghost of that doily. Here I wanted to see if I could use that paper towel that I cleaned up with, because there was so much good pigment in there. I was trying to see if I could use that as a stamp pad. So I'm putting some powder directly onto this just to see how that would work. You could try inking up a stamp with this. You could try pressing your paper into that to see what you get. Now I did see another blogger use a baby wipe in that fashion, and it worked really well. Did not work really well for me with this paper towel, but you gotta try stuff, right? And that's the best way to learn. I don't use baby wipes anymore, so I didn't have any of those to try. But I thought it was a fun technique anyway, so I wanted to try it with a paper towel. Now you can stamp onto wet backgrounds and get this kind of ghosted effect, which I think is kind of cool. And you know, then you can all, that this time I took that scrap of paper and pressed it down just to see. Now I let the stencil dry in the paper, and this is what I got. I really love that effect because it looks like a batik. So just keep playing. Let your stencils dry on your paper if you want a more strong look, if you're doing that stencil on a wet background technique. Now this is a very kind of classic watercolor technique here. What I did was I just tapped a little bit of the pigment powder onto a glass plate or ceramic plate, and then I'm just picking it up with a wet brush and I'm watercoloring. So you can do really controlled looks with this as well. Now, if you're just wanting to watercolor an image, I think this might be a bit of a hassle to do it this way if you have regular watercolors. But if you don't have watercolors and you want to watercolor an image and you have pigment powders, that is a perfect use for those. And if you got them all out anyway, you might as well use them while they're out, right? Now you can find some pigment powders that have a pearlescent sheen. The Cosmic Shimmer ones have a pearlescent sheen. Or you could even take some mica powder and mix it in with a little bit of gum arabic to make it stick, and use that with your powders if you want to get that shimmery look. And if you don't have that, you might find some old eyeshadows that have that mica in it that you could use. Probably won't be as shimmery as the art supply stuff, but definitely would get the job done. Now this was kind of a fun one. I wanted to do a rainbow behind the giraffe, and I thought my first experiment was to paint just a strip of water and then add the powder to it, but it was just too uncontrolled and I couldn't get it to flow exactly where I wanted, so I decided to just go in with a brush and do three colors. Because these colors are so transparent and bright and clean, I knew that they would cause the secondary colors to happen just fine and I wouldn't get any mud. So I just went with those three colors and just let them mix as they wanted to. And it was just kind of fun because the colors swirl together a little bit and you get a little bit of an unexpected result. And I know some people don't like unexpected results in their artwork, but if you're just making a bunch of backgrounds and playing, I think even the most particular crafters could get something out of trying these techniques. So here's another kind of watercolor technique we're going to do. We're just going to be adding, the color to the wet background directly from the powder, but then we're going to spread it with our brushes a little bit. So there's a couple different ways you can do it. You could do it very detailed and very particularly applied with a brush, or you could kind of sprinkle it on and spread it around with a brush. It really depends on the look you're going for. Now, something like this, where you have a really busy kind of like rooftop city scene, you probably wouldn't want to paint every single little thing, because then you would lose that strong design in that stamp. All the stamps I'm using are by Kesselcraft, by the way. I think it looks better if you kind of have a loose, swashy background and you let the black stamping kind of show you the design. It's a different look and it's also really fast. So if you wanted to paint, like maybe use a similar scene or use this technique on Christmas cards or maybe birth announcements or something where you're making a bunch of the same card, it would be a really fun technique because it doesn't take a lot of time, but it's also very handmade and artsy looking. And I think those are the most fun cards to receive when you can tell that somebody was like playing with their supplies. It's like you can see the fun and the joy that the card maker had when they were making the card. Now, to pick up any like excess, if you have any puddles, just wipe your brush off and set it in the puddle and soak up the extra. That way you won't end up with any like ruffly edges, unless you want that, and in that case you can leave the puddles there. But I just kind of drag the paint around to fill in any spaces I missed, but you don't have to be too careful. It's got a, when you've got a stamp with a really strong design, a scene like that, just let the paint flow and it looks great. And there you can see the finished cards that I made with these techniques today and some of the backgrounds that we made. They were so much fun. I hope that you give some of these a try because, you know, it's a great way to spend an afternoon. Just I would wear some gloves or make sure you have some good soap on hand. I used lava soap and got most of the ink off my hands and out from under my fingernails, but gloves would have made everything a lot easier. Also, make sure you protect your work surface when you are working because it could stain, definitely stain your tabletops and counters and things like that. So put down a Teflon mat or open up a plastic trash bag or something on your table to keep that. I really like that salt technique. I thought those colors looked really well. And that one was just a little same technique, just done with darker colors. And you never quite know what you're going to get until the backgrounds are dry. That was more of like applied like a watercolor. It's just a kind of like, it's kind of like a big surprise. It's a surprise when you're done. What was your favorite technique? I would love to know in the comments below. I hope you try these. If you have any questions, you can also ask me in the comments and I'd be happy to help you out. I just think these are so fun and they were really fun to make cards with when I was done. If you're curious about any of the supplies I used today, I'll have a supply list in the video description. Also a link to our sponsor, topflightstamps.com. All the stamps I'm using are from Quetzalcraft. Quetzalcraft is a company from France, one of the wonderful discoveries that I made through topflightstamps.com, and I think you'll enjoy their stamps too. They're really fun, witty, and always bring a smile to my face, and I hope to the people who I send cards to as well. Check them out at topflightstamps.com. Thank you so much for watching. Please give me a thumbs up before you go, and until next time, happy crafting!